Out in the open tonight with our panel, Air America radio host Rachel Maddow, Ryan Smith, an attorney and co-host of BET's My Two Cents. Your first time on. Welcome, right?
Yeah, thank you for having me.
And Ben Ferguson. He's an old hat. He's here all the time, a nationally syndicated radio talk show host. Welcome back. Thanks. Rachel, I want you to take a look at these staggering numbers, and it's a comparison of how many more refugees Sweden's taking in, the Netherlands and Germany, than what the United States is. And you're talking about some countries who weren't a part of this fighting.
That's right. It's not the fact.
Are you ashamed by this?
Absolutely. I mean, for Sweden to have taken that kind of responsibility for the mess that we created with the invasion and the subsequent occupation of Iraq, they weren't part of this military fiasco. We were the ones who started it, and for us to not be taking in the people who are the human calamity that's the result of that is a national shame, I think.
Is that the U.S.'s responsibility?
I don't know if it's so much that we have to take in every refugee that's out there. Let's think about this, because what we say a lot of times is, well, we caused this, so now we have to house every refugee. That would be very difficult for us to do. And I don't think it's as simple as us just taking in everyone who's in trouble.
Between 1975 and 1980, we took in 500,000 Vietnamese and Cambodian refugees in this country. That was the right thing to do. Why is it not the right thing to do now?
But you have to look at geography, and you have to look at where these places are and how close they are to Iraq. It's unfair to say that we're not doing our fair share. We're over there, A, protecting these people, B, the American soldiers are giving their lives to these people every day. And the reality is, it's to say that America somehow doesn't have open arms for people. We've got 15 million people that we've opened our arms from Mexico. If Iraq was right next door, they would be coming to America. You have to look at the demographics of this.
Are you saying
you have
that,
to look at the world, and you have to look at these places are closer for these people to go and
Sweden
live.
Because Sweden borders Iraq? This is
I'm not saying it borders. My point is it's a lot closer than America is.
All right.
Let me
throw out another geography challenge for you now. These are a whole bunch of statistics taking a look at what happened over a six-month period where the government, the U.S. government, gave more than 20,000 people refugee status. Well, you're talking about countries like Somalia, Iranians, Burmese, Cubans, Iraqis, seven. You think that's justified?
I think people go where they want to go. And if you look at Sweden, if you look at what the report said, people are going there before Saddam was taken out of power. People go where their friends and families go. The same reason that people from Mexico keep coming to America. The same reason why Iraqis are going to Sweden is because they already have roots there. They have friends there. They have people that can get them into business there. That's why they have so many people going there.
I have to disagree with that.
The idea that people
don't want to come to America. These refugees want to be here. You don't think they do? You don't think they want to be here?
I'm sure they want to. I'm sure some of them want to come to America, but they also want to come where their friends are. And if most of their friends are in Sweden,
so you're saying. So you're saying the number is 70 because they don't have enough friends and family here to justify them coming here. That's why the number is 70.
I'm not saying it shouldn't be 7,000 or 70,000, but my point is they're going to go places where they know people, and I don't think that America is not doing its fair share. We're over there right now. Men and women are giving their lives.
What about that, Rachel? Because by this stage of this process, people were hoping that this Iraqi government would gain more strength and would have a much better ability to control its population.
Yeah. What's happened instead is that the Iraqi government is not stable. The Iraqi government is not a sole source of legitimate use of force in their country. People are not only internally displaced, but they are internationally displaced. They would love to be able to come to the United States. The United States government is saying no. It's not that the Iraqis don't want to come here, and they'd be welcome if they did. The U.S. government is saying no. Other governments are saying yes, and that's unconscionable for us as a nation, as the country who started this problem.
I think you have to look at the reason why America's saying no right now is because, in your words, is because we're over there trying to help build them their houses and their schools, and allowing women to go to school, allowing women to hold office, allowing women to be educated, for that matter, in their country, instead of just, you know, band-aiding the problem, having them come to America and saying, oh, we'll take you in for a little while. We're actually trying to set their own country for them.
Band-aiding the problem by saving their lives, yeah.
All right, hang on. We got a lot more to debate tonight. Hold your fire. Twitter Out in the Open panel has to say about non-candidate Bloomberg. Joining me again, Rachel Maddow, Ryan Smith, Ben Ferguson. Of course, every politician tells you they have the intention of finishing out their term. Is this guy going to be a spoiler?
He's not going to be a spoiler. This is a bit of a ploy, and I think he knows that without Republican support, without Democratic support, what is he really going to do? He doesn't... He's not really popular outside of New York. No one really knows him. He doesn't have that Rudy Giuliani personality or 9/11 behind him. He's just an independent guy out there with a lot of money and a lot of bluster.
And a very popular mayor.
People like what he's done.
That's a popular mayor in New York, not enough to win a national election.
But, you know, there are more people in America who describe themselves as not affiliated with any political party than there are people who identify themselves as Republicans.
But does that
and
mean...
So, I mean, will all those people be willing to support somebody who's a none-of-the-above candidate as well? It remains
no,
to be
you,
seen.
Look, you could take the front runner from the Republican Party and make him switch 2 days before the election to an independent, and he would still lose. You could take the Democrat, who's the front runner of the Democratic Party, and he could switch to an independent, and he would guarantee a loss there, because America's not ready for a third party. People say they're not satisfied with the Republicans or the Democrats, but they know you can't get elected. And I'll tell you,
As we have learned in the past, those independent candidates can certainly make a mess of the race, can't
yeah,
they?
Yeah, and I think
maybe
that's
the wrong word. Some people were very happy to see Ross Perot jump in.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you look at Ross Perot and what he did. He spoiled it for George Bush, 41. And you look at even Nader and how he spoiled it in many ways for Al Gore. You got to look at this guy and say, he's got the money. He could be an eighth-tier candidate, but he's got the money to make an impact. And it may only take 1% or 2% to lose it for another guy.
I think the lesson of Ross Perot is often misread. Ross
Perot... I thought you were going to say 1-800 numbers. No. I probably still know that number.
The most important impact of Ross Perot is that we still talk about the giant sucking sound, honestly. Ross Perot took votes from both candidates, and I don't think that it's clear to be said that he spoiled that election for George H.W. Bush. The important thing about Ross Perot is that he got 19% of the popular vote and zero electoral votes, because the electoral college system and the political system more generally is stacked against independent
candidates. So he'll have an effect. But you know what? Americans in this country, we need a sense of security in our parties. We generally know what Republicans think. We generally know what Democrats think. And we need that sense of security. Without that, we don't know what's going to happen when that person goes into office.
Ben, I want you to react to something Mayor Bloomberg had to say yesterday about how fed up so many Americans are with the state of, what would you call it, paralysis in Washington. Let's listen.
More than ever, Washington is sinking into a swamp of dysfunction. No matter who's in charge, sadly, today, partisanship is king. It has become a contest in Washington to one-up the other side and to score points for the next election.
So I don't understand, Ben, why you so swiftly write off the possibility that an independent candidate could never make it.
I just don't think it's going to happen in my lifetime. There's too much money.
But you're so young, Ben.
I'm a young guy.
You got another 70 years. It could happen.
I don't think it's going to happen. The reason is because the parties have the money. They have the business backing. They have the lobbying groups. They have voter blocks that vote for those parties because they have congressmen and senators that they need and governors and locally elected officials to get things done on their agenda. And you look at this guy and you got to wonder two things here. Either one, he's trying to scare people and, hey, maybe he'll get a cabinet position out of it. Or two, maybe he's got a ton of money, he's bored, has a huge ego, and he just wants to be famous coast to coast. Reminds me a lot of Ross Perot. Look at their bank accounts.
We just need to know. As Americans, we just want to know. We're at home. We don't know how people are going to vote when they're in office. And that's the one thing we like about a Republican or a Democrat. We know that he can't get too far afoot. But I think that a lot of Americans feel that way. They can't get too far afoot because they belong to a certain party. What if they just decide to go willy-nilly do whatever they want
I think Americans look at Michael Bloomberg, and the one thing they really like about him is that he is totally transparent about the fact that party labels mean nothing to him. He was a Democrat for 40 years before he became a Republican, and he was transparent about the fact that he did that just to get in the spot on the ticket and he wanted to get on to run for mayor of New York.
It's kind of refreshing. It's refreshing.
That's what's going to kill him coast to coast, the fact that he was a Democrat, became a Republican because he had such a big ego, he wanted to have that position because he could do anything else.
Billionaires who are the mayors of New York have big egos. People expect their presidential candidates to have big egos.
They don't expect them to flip-flop on parties, and that's what people want.
As Americans, we do want that sense of loyalty. We do want to know that our president can stick to something. I think that's true.
All right.
No way, man.
Oh, Rachel Stilling. No. Rachel Maddow, Ryan Smith, Ben Ferguson. Thanks.